Dear friends, dear colleagues, please let me introduce myself. My name is Dr. Amin Xiaim, associate professor working in Monastir Medical School. The lesson of this day is about esophageal atresia. Esophageal atresia is defined as the interruption in the continuity of the esophagus with or without tracheal fistula. This is a life-threatening situation and should be managed as an emergency. The incidence of esophageal atresia is about 1 to 3,000 births with a slight male predominance. The pathogeny of esophageal atresia is related to abnormal separation of the gastrointestinal and respiratory tracts. And even the etiopathogeny is unknown, this incident is an early anomaly producing between the 24th and the 36th day. That means we will have a high predominance of associated anomalies. Some hypotheses were evocated for the etiopathogeny of esophageal atresia, like viral, genetics, or toxic. For esophageal atresia, we have many classification depending on the communication between the pouches and the trachea, and also between the gap between the two pouches. I chose this classification to explain to you. For the type A, here we will have the two pouches of the esophageal atresia without any communication with the trachea. And this is seen in 10% of the cases. In type B, we will have a communication between the upper pouches and the trachea. And the type C, we will have communication between the lower pouch of the esophagus and the trachea. And this is the most common form of esophageal atresia. And in the type D, we will have both communication between the upper pouch and the lower pouch with the trachea. In esophageal atresia, the associated malformations are frequent. It's about 30% of the cases. We can have cardiovascular, vertebral, digestive, and urinary malformation. This associated malformation or this malformation can be associated in syndromes like Vater or Vactors that are probably the best known. Vater for vertebral, anal, tracheoesophageal and renal malformation, and Vactor for vertebral, anal, cardiac, tracheoesophageal, renal and limbs. Regarding physiopathology, we can have repercussion of esophageal atresia in the antenatal period with polyhydramnios and low weight. And at birth, we can have signs that were related to the upper esophagus pose with especially aspiration danger. And also we will have some signs that are related to the presence or not of the lower tracheoesophageal fistula, which means the type 3 or type C of esophageal atresia. In this case, we can have gastric liquid reflux in the lungs and the decreasing of the ventilatory volume. In fact, if we will have a fistula in the lower pouch, here the air will pass in the intestine and we will have distension of the abdomen that can compromise the movement of the diaphragm. And also we can have the reflux of the gastroesophageal liquid in the lungs, and this also can be very harmful to the lung. Also, we can have this aspiration danger in the upper pouch. The diagnosis of esophageal atresia can be done by the ultrasound before birth in 12% of the case. We can have polyhydramnios with fluid shifting in the upper pouch. At the birth, the diagnosis is easy to do, with the impossibility to pass a feeding tube into the stomach, and this is mandatory. This test is mandatory for each baby. This this must be done systematically to not see the aspiration danger or the postnatal drawing of saliva or bronchopneumonia. And as you see here are the examples of plain X-ray of patient with esophageal atresia. Plain X-ray is very important for the diagnosis of esophageal atresia, and also it can give us also some precious information. First of all, the plain X-ray with a feeding tube in the upper poche will confirm the diagnosis. Here you see the gastric tube that arrested in the mediastinum, and the projection is really posterior, so this means that it is an esophageal atresia. But also, we must see if there is presence of air in the intestine or not. If there is air in the intestine, this means that we have a distal tracheoesophageal fistula. And this means probably that the gap between the two poches is not very huge and the primary anastomosis is possible. But if we will not have any air in the intestine, this means that we will not have the distal tracheoesophageal fistula, and this means that probably the gap between the two poches is very huge and primary anastomosis is very difficult to do. Also, we must see if there is any repercussion in the lungs, like atelectasia, due to this aspiration danger. And also, in the simple X-ray, we must see if there is any vertebral anomalies. This is very important. You see, a simple X-ray can show us many information for this esophageal atresia. And also, we will see if there is any cardiac anomalies in the X-ray. We must not do opacifications. This is very important because we will have this aspiration danger and this can damage the lungs. Now the diagnosis is done of esophageal atresia. What is our pre-operative workup? First of all, we should perform a continuous suction of the upper pouch through the feeding tube. The baby should be nursed in the intensive care unit. Immediate surgery is rarely required. We should first of all assess to other malformation and especially cardiac malformation. If needed, we must perform endotracheal tube or endotracheal intubation beyond a possible distal tracheoesophageal fistula, and mask ventilation is contraindicated because this will aggravate the situation. This will aggravate the abdominal distension, and this can aggravate the dyspnea. And as every baby, we must prevent infections and hypothermia. The treatment will depend on the situation. If there is a distal tracheoesophageal fistula or without tracheoesophageal fistula. In fact, we have two strategies. The first strategy is esophageal atresia with distal tracheoesophageal fistula. Here we should perform a fistula closure with primary anastomosis. This can be realized with thoracotomy or with thoracoscopy. And in case of esophageal atresia without distal tracheoesophageal fistula, here we will perform gastrostomy with upper post suction or esophagostomy. And after we will do our anastomosis or an esophageal replacement. So here you see the steps in the esophageal atresia with distal tracheoesophageal fistula. Usually we should perform an endoscopy to confirm the presence of this fistula that you see here in this example. We'll do thoracotomy or thoracoscopy. And we prefer to do extra pleural approach in thoracotomy with the ligation here of the fistula, the tracheoesophageal fistula, which is distal. And after, we'll perform our anastomosis between the two pouches. And as you notice, the upper pouch is very well vascularized, so we can dissect as much as possible this upper pouch, and after we'll perform our anastomosis. For this first strategy, the results, so we can see the mortality in 19 to 20% of the cases. This would depend especially in the associated malformation and especially cardiac malformation. We can see early complication like bronchopulmonary complication, like anastomosis, anastomotic fistula also. Also we can have other complication, late complication like tracheoesophageal recurrence, like you see in this case. You can see also gastroesophageal reflux, or you can see also stenotic anastomosis like you see in this example. Other late complications can see like esophageal peristaltism anomaly. We can have swallowing trouble, dysphagia, but this can enter in the pathology of the esophageal atresia, and should in most cases we will have like an accommodation of this esophagus to the new situation and an improvement of the functional issue with time. We can also have recurrent bronchopneumonia due to gastroesophageal reflux or to tracheomalacia. So here we can have examples of tracheomalacia. You must notice that the surgery of esophageal atresia is surgery with many complications. We can see mortality in 7.5% of the cases. We can have morbidity with anastomotic stricture, anastomotic leak, vocal accord paralysis and paralysis, recurrent fistula and anastomotic dehiscence. I showed you this article just to confirm that surgery of esophageal atresia, we can see a lot of complication, and we must manage this complication because this kind of patient can be saved with surgery. The complication factors depend on the gap and also on the surgeon experience. Regarding long gap esophageal atresia, here we will perform initial gastrostomy with Thaksin or esophagostomy. We will try to preserve the native esophagus as much as possible. Otherwise, some will prefer to do replacement using stomach, colon, or even small intestine. Here I want to show you a new operative approach that we are using in Monastir in Tunisia, using a combined thoracotomy and also cervicotomy for long gap esophageal atresia. This cervicotomy can allow us to enhance the dissection of the upper pouch, because this upper pouch is very well vascularized, and we can do our dissection as much as possible to correct also any curvature of this upper pouch and to perform at the end our end-to-end anastomosis. So, in conclusion, long gap esophageal atresia is the most common esophageal malformation, and without surgery this will lead to death. And thanks to the improving of resuscitation, the mortality is decreasing. Thank you very much for your attention.